Welcome to Words From My Face. On tonight's show, we are talking about the summer TV finales and which one of them you should have watched. We're also talking a lot of quick hits. There's a lot of those going on. But we have the Battle of the Jungle Books and talking about Destiny Writer leaving for Telltale Games. Stay tuned. Greatest round ones of all time, of all sports, ever.
You think, though, Beverly Hills Cop, RoboCop crossover needs to happen?
What is going on, everybody? Welcome to Words to My Face. My name is Brian. With me, as always, producer extraordinaire, Brendan.
You.
And we are the one and only home of the Chewbacca chainsaws. Yes, 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 and it is Monday night, so of course it's an entertainment night where we're bringing you all of our favorite things that happen in the world of TV, movies, and video games, and usually quick hits as comics. I mean, that's just how it breaks down. I don't think anybody minds.
I don't mind. If you mind, you might want to take it up with our complaints department.
Yes. Chewbacca. And him and his chainsaw will show you what we do with all complaints. And it's not pretty. I don't want to. This is a family show. Not really, but yeah, whatever. We can't get into details on the show. That's all I can say. It's not pretty. Not pretty.
For confidentiality purposes, we can't get into it.
But let's start it out this week the same way we start it off every week, and that is with the Horrible Movie of the Week review. And so this week, I did watch a movie, and this was actually a major theater release a couple months ago, and yeah, it was horrible. So I watched Homefront, and that was starring Jason Statham and James Franco, yeah, and Winona Ryder was in it too.
So there's
actually some actors in this movie that have done good things previously, but when they come together in this one, it just doesn't work. So the movie is about an ex-DEA/Interpol/undercover guy who infiltrates a biker gang and takes them down. And the movie just started out with a hilarious note, and that's because Jason Statham, we all know him as the guy who always has a shaved head, you know, doesn't really look like he can grow much hair, but they gave him a nice wig, and he had long hair in the beginning just to fit in with those bikers.
Okay.
Yep. So if you've ever wondered what Jason Statham would look like with long hair, check out the movie. If not, and you're like everybody else in this world and never cared what he would look like with long hair, stay away. That's all I gotta say. So, yeah. So of course, he infiltrates the gang, breaks up a big drug meth bust or something like that, and long story short, one of the leader's kids gets killed, and he was also a bad biker guy, so it kind of was his fault for getting killed, but yeah, that happens. And so, of course, the father, who was the leader of the biker gang, vows revenge, and a couple years go by. You're like, oh, it's nice and peaceful. And Jason Statham moves to a nice little country bumpkin place where, you know, there's not many people, probably like one stoplight in the whole town. And just so happens that he moved into the one town with a huge meth ring being operated in it. And they apparently know the biker gang who he infiltrated. And so, yeah, his cover gets blown.
And they
so
recognize him. Guys in a meth lab recognize him on the streets.
The stupidest thing about how he gets caught, like he gets recognized, is his daughter, he has a daughter in the movie, beats up a little bully kid, and then that mother happens to be a meth head tweaker, and she was like, I want revenge on you for your daughter beating up my son. It's America. And so she sicks her meth-dealing brother on him, and he finds out that he's a DEA agent. So that's where stuff tends to get interesting. And I just got to note this, that James Franco, I'm sorry, after Pineapple Express, I can never, ever be scared of you. You are not a scary character. So when you try to play an intimidating character, it doesn't work out so well for you, buddy. Sorry. Just doesn't work. So, yeah.
Sucks to be you, I guess.
Yeah, and so the main story, like the main conflict of the story gets going is when he finds out that this guy's a DEA agent, and he even mentions this in the movie. He's like, oh, I don't think he's after us. I think he's just kind of, you know, trying to blend in. He's not trying to start any trouble. But let's get some guys to go over and shoot up his house anyway. Hey, that won't stir the pot for us, you know, huge drug dealers trying to stay below the radar. Because
shooting Interpol officers always goes well. Like, they never react to that. Never.
Yes. Yeah, never. Never. No, I mean, like, just a couple guys with Uzis and stuff, you know, they're like, it's cool, guys. It's just Thursday. We're all right. You know, it's yeah, not a good idea. So, apparently in this movie as well, there's one scene where he is getting shot at by some guys with some automatic rifles, and he's, like, picks the skinniest tree he can find to hide behind, and he's, like, all hidden behind it, but, like, more of himself is sticking out from the tree than is hidden by the tree, but yet the tree seems to absorb all the bullets being shot at him.
That's a magical tree.
Magical tree.
I wish I had that tree.
Protect me. Magical tree. Picked the magical tree. And another thing is all the bad guys seem to know MMA. That's a thing in this town because there's multiple scenes where he's like doing weird like jujitsu moves and stuff like that, and you think you're watching an MMA match, and it's just like, wait.
All right, hold on. Now that I can believe.
No, not every redneck country bumpkin out there knows MMA. Come on.
They all do.
They don't.
You might have been a while since you've been out of the country, but the ones that do meth, That's all they do. They do meth and practice MMA.
Meth and MMA. That's what they do. You know.
But
hey,
also, like, okay, maybe they're not all. Maybe they wouldn't in reality. But this is a movie. It's okay to add in some action stuff because I don't want to watch amateurs fighting in a movie. I paid money. I want to see.
They gotta be MMA fighters. So yes. Yeah. Yeah, and so what is the one thing that bad guys do in every movie and every TV show that they're always like, why did you do this? Don't ever do that. And so you'd think everybody wouldn't do this, but they do it anyway. Right after you commit the crime, drive while they're following you, drive straight back to your secret hideout. It's just not smart.
Where else are you going to go?
Anywhere else until you lose them and then go back to your secret hideout. So, yeah. And note to everybody out there, I didn't know this before I watched the movie, but apparently if you turn on the lights in a meth lab, it will explode. Spontaneously combust, just like that.
That's what happens.
So, yeah, I guess meth heads like the dark.
You like the dark.
Well, I'm not a meth head. I do like the dark, though.
Maybe they do during the day, Brian.
And I gotta say that in this movie, you have the most convenient drawbridge ever. Because it just so happens they're chasing the bad guy around who has kidnapped the DEA agent's daughter, and there somehow is a drawbridge in front of them that they can raise to stop said bad guy.
Yeah. And that's how they actually stop him? Like, they don't do a whole, you know, jump over the drawbridge scene?
They kind of, a little bit, but it wasn't good, so I'm just gonna say that they didn't. It was just a disappointing movie. Now, it wasn't the worst movie I've ever watched on Horrible Movie of the Week, but it was just pretty darn bad. So I'm going to go with 2 stars out of 5, or 2 Chewbacca chainsaws. Why do I say stars? 2 Chewbacca chainsaws out of 5. Yep, so they got all 2, and... yeah, I'm in the habit of usually changing my Chewbacca chainsaw count right after, but I'm going to... This is a solid 2 Chewbacca chainsaw ones, so... it doesn't hurt to watch, but it doesn't feel good to watch either, so... Yeah. Yeah.
Unlike Chewbacca chainsaws.
Those hurt all the time. Those never feel good. Just saying. But let's take that, and let's expunge the horrible movie of the week from our memories and talk about something that I don't know if it's going to be a good movie, to be honest with you. It just sounds kind of ridiculous. But that is The Battle of the Jungle Books. Dun dun dun.
Dun dun.
Dun 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 dun, dun, dun. There we go. I guess that's our Jungle Book sound effect from now on.
Yes. Thunder.
So what movies? Thunder. You must play that sound of thunder. But yeah, and so if you didn't know, there's actually 2 studios. Thundercats. But there are two studios right now working on some Jungle Book movies, and I believe one of them is going to be a live action, one of them is going to be a CGI movie. I'm not 100% sure on that. But we have Disney, with Jon Favreau set to direct, doing a Jungle Book movie. So that'll be, we were discussing it before the show, I think Disney's third Jungle Book movie.
Yeah, because there's the old cartoon one, and then I think Disney made the live-action one back in, like, the mid-90s, right?
So I think they did, too. So, yeah, so this will be their third venture into the Jungle Book land. And then you have WB actually somehow got the rights to the Jungle Book movie, too. And they have a new
director. By somehow got the rights, you mean it's the stories in the public domain, so they can do whatever
Disney
they want. Yeah,
but Disney does stuff where they, like, steal public domain stuff.
Yeah, I know. But they...
It's called Snow White, Cinderella, Aladdin.
You just have to work around certain things, so...
So they're doing it, and they have a new director, Andy Serkis, is going to be directing this one. And if you don't know him, he's actually been Phil Jackson's second director with the Lord of the Rings Hobbit trilogy. So he's done some things there. He mainly focused on the scenes with CGI, especially with Smaug. So if they do a CGI movie, yeah, it'll probably be pretty good. And so I'm just trying to decide which one is going to be the winner. Now, Disney is a little bit further along. They haven't announced a cast. You have Idris Elba, who will be Shere Khan in the movie. You have Scarlett Johansson's going to be in the movie. Bill Murray, Christopher Walken, Ben Kingsley, and Lupita Nyong'o are all in the movie. So that makes me kind of think that that's more of the voice acting cast, so that'll be like a CGI / animated one as well. But
probably.
I'm not 100% sure. And then on the other side, WB side, now they've only announced one actor, and that is Benedict Cumberbatch, and that he's from Star Trek Into Darkness, the Sherlock show, which he's been amazing with that. He actually did Smaug, too, from Desolation of Smaug. Smaug. That's just weird to say Smaug.
That already actually puts them ahead to me, because, I don't know. Yeah, I would imagine, too, like we were saying, Disney's done this one several times, and one of the ways that they keep things, they like steal the public domain stuff is they change the story up significantly, water it down usually a little bit to be a little bit more family friendly and things like that. So I'm going to venture that this one will be closer to the darkness of the books, which I have never read, so I don't know if they're really that dark. But I'm going to guess.
Might be dark.
I would assume so. I mean, there's like a kid abandoned in a jungle with a bunch of tigers and crap.
Yeah, I guess that could be pretty dark, yeah. And if he can then talk to said, like, panther and bear, that'd be pretty weird. Could go dark. Could be like, you know, the Mowgli Returns, the Frank Miller comic. That'd be interesting.
Yeah,
Miller should do a Jungle Book. I would totally jump behind Frank Miller's Jungle Book.
Yes.
Just agree. But yeah, it's going to be interesting, and they're both kind of, I believe they're both slated for a 2016 release, so this is going to be really interesting. This, we haven't quite seen something like this since we saw two James Bond movies come out in 1 year, and now I wasn't alive when that happened, so I couldn't really tell you too much about that, but there was a time when two competing James Bond movies came out, so it was kind of interesting. But
I mean, this is a little bit more of a particular trend, but I mean, we see all the time that for whatever reason, two movies that have essentially the same concept that has never really come up before just get released around the same time. Like, one that I always think of is like Ants and Bug's Life just happened to be released the same year. It's like, oh, two movies, two CGI movies about ants trying to live.
Well, and you do see this a lot with especially like the Asylum or Phase 4 films where those guys will say, oh, there's a Hercules movie coming out. Let's just release a really crappy thing, and maybe people will mistake our movie for that movie and watch ours instead. You know, so
yeah, whatever it is. You know. I think there were some like a couple like fairy tale movies released a couple years ago, right? That at just the same time, pretty much. Wasn't there? I don't know. Mm-hmm. Well, there was the Snow White movie, Snow White and the Huntsman, and then there was the Maleficent movie.
Yeah, but those are years apart.
Sleeping Beauty or whatever it is. I don't know.
They're all
there's
the same.
A bunch of stuff like that.
they do that with
like this is essentially the same movie they just did twice, like, so, by two different people.
Yeah, but you're right. I think you're right. I think Benedict Cumberbatch kind of puts this one above, even though I love Idris Elba. He's going to be playing Shere Khan up for the other side. So, yeah, I'm just kind of up in the air. Who cares, really? to be honest with you. I like Jungle Book, so
we
I want to see Jungle
Book. That's why we did the story, apparently.
No, I'm just saying, who cares which side, you know, I just want to see a good Jungle Book movie. I don't care which studio is making it. But Jon Favreau is a pretty cool director, so that might tip it the back that way.
I want a good Jungle Book movie that's like into Heart of Darkness.
Heart of Darkness, Jungle
Book. That was about the jungle. That was about the Congo, so.
Yeah. Oh, there you go. But as long as they bring the vultures back, if they do not have a reoccurrence of the vultures, and if you don't know what I'm talking about, go back and watch the movie. It's towards the end. They're sitting in the rain. They're all on the branch. And one of them goes, "So what do you want to do?" "I don't know. What do you want to do?" "I don't know. What do you want to do?" And then another one hits them both on the head. "Now don't start that again. So what do you want to do, guys?" "I don't know. What do you want to do?" Greatest part of the movie.
So what you're saying is you want the comedy, not the darkness.
Yes. Well, the darkness can come too. That's fine too. As long as you have the vultures in there doing that bit.
I guess if you do it with vultures, it can be really dark humor. Because, you know, they're really trying to eat, you know, the rotting flesh of the dead.
Yeah. Well, they're waiting for Mowgli to get killed, pretty much, is what they're doing. They're waiting around like, "When's this kid going to get killed?" "I don't know. When is he going to get killed?" "I don't know. When do you think?" "I don't know. I want to peck out his eyeballs." "I know, me too." Like, that's what they're really waiting for.
Yeah. So what I'm hearing is Vulture Heart of Jungle Darkness.
Jungle Book, Vulture Heart of Jungle Darkness. There you go. But yeah, I don't know. Let us know what you're looking forward to. Hit us up in comments down below. Of course, at WordsToMyFace on Twitter, WordsToMyFace@gmail.com, Google Plus and Facebook, all good ways to get a hold of us. So let us know what you're looking forward to in the Jungle Book movie. Yay, Jungle Book.
If you're looking forward to seeing me in the Jungle Book movie, let those studios know.
We'll get them in there. If you saw our fantasy football tips video that we released over the weekend, that was him doing the numbers. That's right. Yep. Mm-hmm. Voice actor of the year. You win it.
Yay!
But yeah, let's move this on and talk about some TV. And now, at the beginning of this summer, I kind of gave you a guide on some TV shows that might be good, might not be, you know, at least something to do while the summer boredom is happening, because for some reason, usually the summer is the dead zone for TV shows. So I gave you a list of a couple ones to look out for, and now we're going to kind of review them since most of those are ending right now. The first one I'm going to start with is Tyrant, and that is an amazing show. And if you haven't watched that one, you really should catch up on demand, whichever way you can, because this show is awesome. It's about not an exiled, but kind of a prodigal son who leaves his country of Abu Dhabi, which is a fake Middle Eastern country, goes to America, and kind of just leaves his past behind because his dad was kind of a dictator and his uncle in the military. So he comes back, his dad dies, his brother's taking over the presidency, and I don't know why they call it a presidency, because he's really like king, because don't presidents have to be elected?
It depends on how you want to present it, you know? Mm-hmm. Like, there's actually been several tyrant regimes that they're elected.
Yeah.
And all the votes somehow go to them in a vast population.
But, well, there you go. So, you know, but, it's actually a pretty cool show, the way they're going through it. Like, he stays because his father dies. He's trying to help his brother become a better president. He kind of is bringing some of his American ideals to everything and, like, convinces his brother to open it up for free and fair elections. And that's a phone ringing. I don't know what to do about that. It's
the worst professional thing I've ever seen. Yeah, but it was still professional because I said
it's
that.
Just rude. Yeah. Good job covering while I was turning off the phone. So, oops. But, yeah.
It would have been a good job covering had you not drawn attention to the
had
job.
Had I not drawn attention to it. Yep, I kind of blew it there. But yeah, Tyrant was awesome. Check it out. It actually ends tomorrow night. I will be missing that. I'll have to catch up on demand because Words to My Face Fantasy Football Draft is tomorrow. It's not the Words to My Face League. It's my league from I've been doing for a couple of years, so just watch it. It'll be awesome. And so that was cool. We talked about The Last Ship at the beginning of the summer, and that was a show about a ship that goes to the North Pole, pretty much. It's these scientists trying to find some, you know, there's a disease spreading across the world. They're trying to find the primordial strain, and they do. And by the time they come back down, and it's taken like 8 months, half the world has been infected, and everybody's dead or dying. And they're all on this last uninfected ship. It looks really good. It has like a big budget movie feel. Rona Mitra, she's lovely in the show. And it's kind of mediocre. I watched most of it. I wasn't really wasn't really too sold on it. It was good. It just wasn't great. You know what I'm saying?
It happens.
I think
they were just trying to jump on that. Like, we're kind of too far off of the zombie trend that now seems like it's, you know, they probably took a while. It's probably just trying too hard to milk that zombie trend because I think we're now on the far side of the zombie trend that's been going on for the last couple of years.
Now it's becoming the virus trend, because there was another show, The Strain. Now, that's not one that I got into. Apparently it was really awesome, though, and it's still kind of going on. I think there's one or two episodes left for this season. I've heard a lot of really good things about it. That was one of the ones I was meaning to catch up on but never did, so check that one out. I hear that one's really good. But that one kind of turns... It's a virus that turns people into, like, vampire zombies, so...
Vampire zombies, because we can.
Because you can. You know, so that was there. And finish it off with Crossbones. That was a show I kind of got into. I was like, yay, a pirate show. And then I was like, yay, John Malkovich, you're awesome. And then it was just not so good, kind of weak. So you don't have to worry about catching up on that one on demand. It just wasn't my cup of tea. I don't know. Even though I really, really like John Malkovich, so sad to say.
You would like John Malkovich.
I would. Because have you ever seen Being John Malkovich?
No.
It's actually a pretty good movie.
I don't want to.
Oh, it's a good movie. Check it out. It's funny. People go into his head and control his body.
Wow. That's special, isn't it?
It
people
was.
Control his body. All that's right. It? That's all you
special.
Got?
It was special. Quit making fun of me.
Is there character development? No. Because everyone's controlling him.
Different characters that control his body. That's
not development. That's just switching. That's schizophrenia.
I guess
everything's already set.
I guess yes. That is a little more schizophrenia than anything. But it's still a good movie, so check it out if you haven't. And there was another show that I was going to talk about, and that was Penny Dreadful. That one was a lot of fun, entertaining. You had Dorian Gray, you had Frankenstein, you had Dracula, all kind of wrapped up in one, so... It was an entertaining one. That was a Showtime show, so if you haven't seen that one, check it out if you can. But that was the good TV shows of the summer that you should either watch or not watch, and I really only told you one show not to watch. So, sorry. Well, no, not sorry. You're welcome. That's what I meant to say. Because that's what everybody's thanking me.
Except Brittany. For me.
Except for Brittany. That's why I kind of paused, and I was like, oh, Brittany wants to say something. And he's like, no, nothing. Nothing at all. But yeah, so let me know if I missed out on any good TV shows of the summer, or do you disagree with me? Am I off base about some of these shows? Hit us up in comments down below, of course, at WordsMyFace on Twitter, WordsMyFace@gmail.com, Google Plus, and Facebook, all good ways to get a hold of us. But I think that makes it time for one of my favorite segments of the night. And I always elongate this so Brennan can get used to it, and I say this every week, and I don't know, are you used to it yet?
Yes.
Okay, so no more messing around. It's time for quick hits of the night. Remix. Quick hits. All right, let's go to the first quick hit. And that is our leaks are that out of the Nintendo Corporation that there are possibly three more characters left to be unveiled for Super Smash Bros. There has been some video leaked about that.
But it's been taken down.
So if you haven't seen it, you won't see it. But it looks like it's going to be Shulk, Bowser Jr., and Ganondorf. So I don't know who Shulk is, but I know who the other two are.
I'm actually kind of excited about seeing Bowser Jr. in there because, I don't know, I always thought Bowser Jr. was a cool character. He doesn't show up in much. Like, he's in the Mario Party series, and I don't... And yeah, I guess he's...
Well, he was cool in Yoshi's Island. He was in Yoshi... He was the protagonist... I mean, antagonist in Yoshi's Island.
It was a small Bowser, but that was actually Bowser, remember?
Yeah, that was Bowser.
Like, because remember, he turns in... Like, he's Bowser as a small kid.
Because it's Mario as a small kid. Okay.
Yeah,
close enough.
I do think he was also in the new Super Mario Bros., though. Because I remember, at the end, you fight both Bowser and Bowser Jr. in New Super Mario Bros. But it's a cool character. It's cool. I like that.
Shulk was from Xenoblade, and I'm not exactly...
really? So that's getting a big, different franchise then. Mm-hmm. Pulling that in. I hear that the Xenoblade games were really good.
So. I never played it myself either. But also, Ganondorf, that's not somebody... I mean, that is somebody we have seen before in the games. Yeah. He's kind of the Captain Falcon clone, where he's a little bit stronger, yet a little bit slower.
Yeah, he's not usually as useful, so I thought that they were going to get rid of him, but maybe they're switching him up. Like, I hope they balance him better, because he's kind of a cool character to be able to play as, but as just a Captain Falcon clone, that's a slow Captain Falcon clone, I don't know. I just never found him that useful. He's not, like, it's great that he's strong, but Captain Falcon was already strong, and Captain Falcon had a lot of speed.
Yeah. So. And if you're playing me in Super Smash Bros. And you're Ganondorf, I usually just, like, drool, because I'm always Fox, and so I can just jump circles around you. It's not even close. Yeah, I'd like three hits from you, and I'm gone, but I won't let that happen.
Right. Yeah, you pretty much don't have to. Like, you know, I mean, if he could ever pull off his version of the Falcon Punch, it'd be great, but Captain Falcon can barely pull that off, let alone Ganondorf with his extra 3 seconds of charge-up time.
And that's where I come up, jump over you, do my splits kick where you go up in the air, do my little screw kick up in the air, and then, whatever that move is, and I knock you out. So that's my playbook, so everybody knows it if you ever play me in Smash Brothers. Great, I just ruined it for myself.
It's okay. No one wants to play with you anyway.
Okay. Well, all right. Well, that solves that problem. But let's move on to the next quick hit. And that is Archie Comics is actually about to reboot the Sonic the Hedgehog series with Sonic the Hedgehog Total Chaos. So it's
Archie
Comics is doing this. They had the rights to the Sonic comics for a long, long time.
That's just weird to me, but all right. Mm-hmm. I guess they're a big comic book distributor.
Well, Archie Comics,
Sega would keep that.
I believe Archie Comics is planning on killing off Archie from the actual Archie series of comics. So
that's still going on?
Yeah.
Jeez, hasn't it been going on for like 70 years?
A million and 5 years.
That one of those eternal series.
It will never, ever go away, and he'll never be picked between the blonde or the brunette. Oh, Archie. Oh, Archie.
What do they have left to say about that? I mean, maybe they just recycle the same stuff for a new audience. Like,
how many more cheeseburgers can Jughead eat, really? I mean, Jughead has eaten all the burgers in the world. That's it. No more. But yeah, so let's move it on to the next quick hit. And that is Action Comics number 1, and you might know that as the introduction of Superman. It's a comic from back in 1938. It just sold for a record $3.2 million on eBay.
Wow.
So if you have a copy of Action Comics number 1, go ahead and hit us up. We'll take it for free. And then eBay, here we come.
Yeah, I mean, I guess that's been around. That's like, what, 80 years ago now, about, right? So it's got that time thing and rarity.
And the introduction of Superman.
Yeah, so a lot of things going for it at this point.
Yeah,
I guess it's gonna, you know, I guess comic books they've had valuable stuff before. I guess they're starting to really reach into the high rollers collector's value at this point.
Yep. So, yeah. If you got $3.2 million, good luck finding a copy. So let's move it on to the next quick hit, and that is Fraxis is to hold Fraxicon. This year, which I find interesting, even though I don't know any other games except for the Civilization game that's coming out with Fraxis. So you're having a whole convention off of one game.
I'm sure that they have a bunch of other games that are just not as big. You know, yeah. Civilization is just a huge, huge hit game. So.
And the last one, Revolutions, was awesome. I'm looking forward to the next one. I can't tell you how much. So, you know, I'm cool with it. Mm-hmm. Let's do it. Fraxicon, here we come. Not really. I think that's like in Seattle, so we're not going out there. That's across the country. What do you think we are made of money here? You think we make any money on this show? No.
However, if you would like to send us some money to go to that con,
hit us up. We'll go. But yeah, so that's that. And let's move it on to the next quick hit. That is Valve has been rated the best video game company to work for.
Again. I think they've received that before, haven't they?
And I believe this is my theory to why they get it, and that is probably because they don't have to make any games. You just show up to work and play games. Like, when was the last time Valve made a game? They never make any games. How long have we been waiting for Half-Life 3?
You still have to support the Steam, you have to support Steam's network and everything. That still rolls out a lot. But yeah, I assume that it's that it does have to do with that, the fact that they're willing to just delay a game perpetually until forever. It's ready, which one, relieves a lot of pressure on the developers, but two, also lets people be satisfied with what they put out. Because when Valve does release a game, it is always golden.
Like, yeah, that's true.
They took a long time to make sure this thing was awesome. Yeah, and without all
the
bugs.
I just hope they don't get into the the Duke Nukem territory where you take too long to get a game out and then it's missed its niche markets. You know. But they do a lot of really cool things, so I love Valve anyway. I'd love to work for Valve. Valve, if you'd like me to work for you, hit me up. I'll come right now. I have no tangible skills in the video game developer industry, but I will come.
You'll talk. You can voice act for them.
There we go. I will voice act all just talk. Your
we'll
voices.
Talk about your games.
Yeah,
about
all day long. All day long. I'll just live stream all day from your offices. I will do that. I will do that. So let's move it on to the next quick hit. And that is that Amazon looks like they're in line to buy Twitch, which is kind of a surprise.
By in line, you mean like did.
Or they did. They did buy Twitch. And that's pretty a sure surprise because everybody was... I don't know if it's finalized yet, but it's pretty surprising because everybody was saying that Google and YouTube were going to buy them. And it made sense why they would want to. But I kind of like this idea too because it kind of keeps it out of their hands so they can't quite monopolize that end of the market.
Yeah, it was big news. It was a big surprise because, yeah, like you said, everyone thought that YouTube was going to get it. And it even seemed like they started, like Twitch already started changing their policies in such a way that made it more YouTube friendly with like the copyright regulations and audio searching and things like that, which is what YouTube was already doing. So it seemed like they were just preparing and ready to just hand things over. But then Amazon swooped in and was like, hey, here's a billion.
Hey, would
you
like
970 million? Cash.
Take this lots of money from us, please. And like,
you know
yes.
What, though? I had thought that YouTube was looking to spend about that much. So I'm thinking probably part of it was when they were in the negotiations, they probably didn't like what YouTube was going to do with the company. But Amazon, from what I heard, is going to let them stay independent. So they're going to own the company, but they're going to let them run themselves the way they want.
So they're giving them $970 million just to be like, all right, just keep doing what you're doing.
Yeah, well, I mean, they get a share of the profit, whatever it is.
And don't get me wrong, I love YouTube. YouTube is amazing. It was generation-breaking. I mean, that is one of the coolest things that we've had in the past 10 years is YouTube come along. I love YouTube. I just think that it's best to keep a lot of the same services or similar type services in different hands. It just promotes better competition and just better for the consumers in general. So I like this move.
Yeah.
But let's move it on to the last quick hit. And that is Guardians of the Galaxy ekes out Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles for number one in the box office this week with 17.6 over Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles 16.8. Coming in third was the If I Stay movie where the girl dies and then gets to decide if she wants to stay on Earth or not. And it's like you have a really crazy, great life. Like, she's like a award-winning cellist, and like she has a really cool boyfriend. So it's like, well, why wouldn't you want to stay on Earth? You're stupid. Just stay. You can die later.
You can die later. What if she has the promises of even better life, afterlife? You know?
Well, of course. But, you know, I mean, it's just a stupid movie premise, if you ask me. Well, and then, okay, so you have a better afterlife. It's like, sweet, go there. You know?
Yeah.
Hey, not a hard decision. Float with the angels or, you know, stay on Earth and possibly get hit by a car because I think that's how she almost gets killed. So, yeah, never mind. I changed my mind. Go back. Go die. Just stay dead.
Don't okay. Whatever. Whatever.
You have convinced me, Brendan. I want her to die in the good
I'm way. Sure they put a little bit more thought into this movie, but then again, with a name like If I Stay, probably didn't put a lot more thought into the movie. No. Reminds me of a few other movies that you just call for the beginning and don't care after it. But I don't know. I didn't see it. Let us know. Did you see it?
She stays. I haven't seen it. I haven't seen any spoilers or anything. But I can tell you right now from the title of the movie, She Stays.
Okay.
Yeah. So I'm, I just saved you from having to watch that movie.
I'm
but
not
yeah.
intrigued by this concept at all, to be honest.
Not at all.
Yeah.
But yeah. So that was the quick hits of the night. Eyeball. Yeah, so, my blood. But yeah, so let's take that and let's talk about some eyeballs. I guess let's talk about some eyeballs. Let's talk about some Vigima games, people. And that is because recently announced, I believe today or yesterday it was announced, or past couple of days, that the Destiny, I believe he was the lead writer on Destiny, I'm not 100% sure, but the Destiny writer, Joshua Rubin, has left Bungie to go work on the Game of Thrones project with Telltale Games. And I just think this is a really cool move. Number one, Destiny looks like one of the greatest games since Halo 3, and Halo 3 was an amazing, amazing game. I really, really, it's probably going to speed up when I buy a PS4 because I want to play this game so bad. It just looks amazing. I mean, I know you feel the same about Destiny.
Yeah, honestly, I like keep telling people Destiny looks like Halo if the guys that made Halo had 15 years of making Halo ahead of them before they made the first one. And were able to, you know, do whatever they wanted from the beginning. Yeah, I guess they did whatever they wanted with Halo, but again, just like, I don't know.
But still, this is I mean, having that experience is very
Yeah, and they can cut the cords with like whatever flack that they had put in previously and didn't really like, and you know, make it fresh. Make like, hey, you know how we can really make a cool FPS and a cool storyline? This is how. Screw all that stuff we screwed up on before. Here we go. They didn't
screw up on much. They really didn't with those games. Those Halo games were very well polished. And they kind of are throwing a more of an open world environment. They were really cool with their co-op, how you could do 4-player co-op, couch co-op, online co-op, doesn't matter where you wanted to co-op, you could co-op. So they're taking that to Destiny 2, and that's going to be awesome. And a lot of people, I wasn't a really huge fan of the story, but a lot of people love those Halo stories.
Yeah, and the fact that this guy is going to Telltale Games, it shouldn't indicate, because we don't know what he exactly is doing there, but it indicates to me that maybe Destiny's story is better than I thought it was going to be, because I didn't care. I was like, Destiny looks kind of cool, probably has a decent story. But I was like, hey, it's going to be an awesome shooter, right? Mm-hmm. But Telltale Games, like, they're known, they have some good storyline. So if this guy is
The Walking Dead was awesome. Yeah, the Walking Dead game was awesome. They took that off of a currently running TV show and took a twist to it. You know, didn't make it the TV show characters, so it's not a direct like it has to be like that. But they did it really, really well. That was excellent, especially season one. Season one was amazing. They had another cool one, The Wolf Within, which was really cool. Just you were kind of this like wolf detective guys thing, Majigger.
Yeah, and I guess you know a lot of the stuff that they're doing, including the Game of Thrones one, it's based on stuff that has already been written, but that's still you know a task to adjust it for a game and to live up to the expectations of a major or other work. Like that's sometimes even harder. So that this guy is of that caliber, you know, it makes me think maybe the Destiny story is going to be better when we actually play through the whole thing.
Yeah, and I think that will make me want to play through the whole thing because, I mean, granted, I was going to get it, and I was going to pop it in, and I was going to play multiplayer. That was going to happen. But now I might really, like, think about, oh, okay, let me burn through the story, too. So, but that also just gives me hope for another game on the horizon, a Game of Thrones game, which, you know, especially, like I said, with these TV tie-in stuff, it can go horribly, horribly, horribly wrong, but this makes me think it's going to be a great adventure through, you know, the Seven Realms and everything like that. It's going to be awesome. Mm-hmm. I wonder how much involvement George R. R. Martin has in it. Probably not much, but it just looks really cool. So, if you're a Game of Thrones fan, which I'm pretty sure you are, just like I am, should be good times.
Yeah, and I mean, honestly, like we talked about, you know, movies traditionally badly translated to games. There's a few exceptions there. TV has similar problems, but mm-hmm. usually that's because they have some studio behind it that's really just trying to churn something out quickly that maybe doesn't have the best talent, or if they do have the best talent, they don't have enough time. Right, yeah. But seems like Telltale is taking its time to make quality, and they have a good team. So,
yeah. So let us know what you're thinking about. Are you looking forward to the new Game of Thrones game? Is this going to adversely affect Destiny? Which no, it won't, because that's coming out next month. They're already done with all the writing. But you know, just let us know what you think about it. Hit us up in comments down below. Of course, at Words for My Face on Twitter, Words for My Face at gmail.com, and blah 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 Google Plus and Facebook. always good places to hit us up. But yeah, I think that just about does it for the show. It's a little bit shorter of a show tonight than normal.
But just barely.
Yeah, by 10 minutes. By 10 minutes. But yeah, so. But as always, I am Brian. With me, as always, producer extraordinaire Brendan.
Yo.
And we are going to headbang our way out of this joint.
Are we?
Well, if you play the song, we will. If you don't play the song, I guess I'll just awkwardly sit here for the next
minute. Maybe you should tell people to come watch us tomorrow.
Oh, that's right. I should probably promo that because we are doing the Words to My Face draft. Now, we are still thinking about starting another league that's actually going to be called Words for My Face. So if you're interested, hit us up. Drop something down in the comments down below. I think we have 5 interested parties, yeah. And so we need 5
and do
more.
Do so quick because we don't have much time before we need to really get this going. You know,
well,
sometime.
Yeah, I want to set that probably either by Thursday or Friday if we are going to do it. So let us know. We'd like to have you join in the league where I will dominate.
Yeah, maybe really we won't have any cash going on with it, but maybe we'll think of a prize, like a trophy for the winner.
Maybe we'll make you a t-shirt, and then I'll just give it to myself, because I will be the winner. I would like a Words to My Face t-shirt. That'd be cool.
Yeah.
I'm really excited about winning my own
I would, too.
Since we've never made them before, so yeah. I'm looking forward to winning my own prize.
We'll see. See how it goes. But all right.
But yeah. Let's do this. All right, when I say let's do this, that's when you hit the music.
No, it's not how I roll.
Don't listen to you, Brian.
Please listen to me. I am the host of the show. Please.
So?
Please
right.
Listen.
No.
All right, now we'll head back our way out of this. And so I do up my hair every night for the show just to mess it up at the end. It's kind of a sad circle.